Now, let's look at this stock exchange quotation. What do we really mean by quotation? Why does any company really look forward for getting itself listed on stock exchange? What are the advantages for a company to get listed on a stock exchange? What are the disadvantages that are built into it? Then, we would also try to see what are the methods by which any company can get itself listed on a stock exchange, right? And what is the major role of an underwriter in a stock exchange? So all these things we will typically take up as a part of this session. Now, whenever we are using the word quotation, a company wants to get a stock exchange quotation. Now, it clearly means any company which has got a stock exchange quotation, the price of that particular company will be displayed on the exchange. On a daily basis or even intraday basis, the price of that particular security shares will be listed on the exchange, and it is typically called as a listed security, and the trading can happen quite comfortably on those listed shares on the exchange. But however, there are quite a few restrictions with respect to what kind of companies can get a stock exchange quotation. Right, a few of them, while there are so many restrictions, at least a few year trading record should be there, few years of running the business, and along with that, there should also be a mechanism wherein at least 25% of the shares should be with the public. So like this, there are different kinds of exchanges which are putting different kinds of restrictions for their particular company shares to be listed on a particular exchange. And one more thing for us to understand is, anytime any company gets a quotation or lists on an exchange, initially there are quotation costs. To get listed on an exchange, there are a good number of professionals who need to be paid because they have to really work towards it. There are accountant based costs because a lot of things have to be looked at from an accounting perspective. Solicitors costs are there. Brokers costs are there. This is a one time cost, but along with that, the exchange would be charging an annual fee for maintaining the listing. So there is a maintenance fee as well. Now, all these things are major costs to the companies which want themselves to be listed on the exchange. But still, companies go for it. Companies get themselves listed on the exchange. Why do you think, or what are the main reasons that drive the companies to get themselves listed on the exchange? One is raise capital. See, not many times a company can just maintain with the capital from the pockets of a few individuals. Either a sole trader mechanism or a proprietorship mechanism may not bring in more capital. But if they have to raise more and more large sums of money as a part of the expansion of the business, probably this mechanism helps in raising capital. From small investments can come from small shareholders, and large number of shareholders can participate in this process and provide the total funding for the company. So they should be able to sell. By doing this exchange listing, the companies are able to sell new shares to a wide range of market. And probably the overall cost of selling is much lesser. Cost of issuing the shares is much lesser through this process. even, okay, this is the first time they want to raise the capital, but many a times, even for further capital raising, right, not now, okay, for the first time when they want to raise an expansionary kind of a plan, generally at that point only they get themselves listed on the exchange and immediately raise the capital. So the initial public offering packaged with the listing on the exchange both go together. But again, at a later point in time, when any company wants to raise some further capital, even for that, the exchange listing becomes more and more comfortable. And the debt, raising new capital in the form of debt, taking a new loan, all these also become more comfortable. The cost of debt goes down because the lenders traditionally feel that this company is much more safer to lend because it has been continuously maintaining the requirements of the exchange for getting itself up, for continuing the listing on the exchange. It is maintaining on a regular basis. So the lenders find it much more comfortable. And even one more important reason, especially for small businesses, which have been initially funded by venture capitalists who are like risk-taking equity investors in the company, or probably any kind of other private equity investments that have typically come up into the company. If they want to exit, the best, one of the best available routes is get the company quoted on the exchange. Right? So this provides an exit route and these guys can realize whatever they have invested by collecting the money from the public. And they can exit, they can sell off their shares to the public. So it becomes one very good exit route. And even more than that, the listing on the exchange makes the shares more and more marketable. And it makes them more and more easy to value. Probably at any point in time, I can find out the worth of the shares. It helps in computing the capital gain tax appropriately. And probably it even acts as a backup, even for individuals. I know the value of my shares, so I can very well use them as a backup for my borrowings. Even if I'm not able to generate my salary, yes, I have the shares as a backup to pay. Right? And even we see nowadays these shares are typically being used in the takeover process. In the takeovers of some other companies, the acquiring company is actually offering its shares to the new company, to the target company. In a takeover process, the acquiring company is actually offering the shares instead of cash, right? So instead of a cash-based acquisition, it is doing a stock-based acquisition. So that way it is making the takeover more and more effective. It's not utilizing the cash, only the new shares being offered. And if there is a confidence that the share price is going to go up, probably even the acquired company, the target company, shareholders also get much more benefit out of the deal. And even if we see lot more of employees schemes, ESOPs, employee stock option plans, or employee share based schemes, they are all becoming more and more attractive. They are making the employees get fully motivated. And all these things become more and more attractive only when the shares of the company are quoted and are listed on the exchange. So because of these various dimensions, probably I can think of even more a good number of advantages. But because of all these various dimensions, the companies are really getting motivated really getting interested in terms of making their shares listed on the exchange means they are going for full stock exchange quotation. Now that we are convinced that the companies which are in a phase of expansion, which are going big, one of the major routes for them to grow is go for a full stock exchange quotation. Now comes, what is the procedure for getting a quotation? What are the different methods that are there for getting a quotation? A few. Initially, we have offer for sale mechanisms. Now, offer for sale, here we have two mechanisms. One, I can look at a fixed price. Two, I can go for a tender based. Then, the three, I can go even with a subscription kind of a mechanism. We'll see what are the three major differences here. Then there could be a placing, or typically called as private placements. And there is also a mechanism which is the introduction mechanism. We'll talk about each one of them. So the more common one, offer by sale. So if I see offer for sale, initially, we'll talk about the fixed price mechanism. This is the most common kind of a method that is followed by majority of the companies. They are getting themselves quoted on the exchange and immediately raising fund also. Quoted and even raising the fund immediately. Now, as the phrase itself is saying, it is at a fixed price. And the company is going ahead with a predetermined number of shares which are going to be offered to the general public. The price is pre-specified, and in majority of the cases, this price is determined by an issuing house, which is a part of the investment bank, which is engaged by the company which wants to go public. And this particular issuing house acts as a lead underwriter in the process. So in this case, the process of the issuing house taking the responsibility of getting the shares of the company issued to the individual shareholders or individuals is what is the process of underwriting. So the issuing house is actually a part of the investment bank, and it, along with offering a professional advice in terms of at what price should the shares of this company be taken to the public, they also get into the overseeing of the entire process. They make sure that all the activities right from stage one are coordinated. And finally, as a part of the underwriting, they even take the responsibility of getting the shares of the company directly to the public. So the company generally does not sell. If the company is directly selling the shares to the public, not via the issuing house, but the company is directly selling the shares to the public, we call them as offer for sale through the subscription mechanism. There the issuing house does not take the responsibility. But in the offer for sale for a fixed price, The issuing house, first of all, purchases the shares. Now it happens like this. The issuing house initially purchases the shares from the company at a specific price. And it takes the responsibility of taking these shares to the public at some other price. Now the difference, the price at which they are selling the shares to the public minus the price at which they have purchased the share from the company is what will contribute to the fee for the issuing house, right? And in this case, if all the shares are not getting sold to the public, they will have to retain all the shares with them and try to sell them later. The company is nowhere responsible. Company has sold all the shares to the issuing house, which means the credit risk, or which means the risk associated with selling of the shares to the public, normally lies with the issuing house itself. So that is where we are calling that it is underwriting the issue. It is taking the ownership and assessing the risk and taking the ownership of selling the shares to the public. Right. So the fee, whichever they charge, which is P2 minus P1, is completely the difference in the price at which the issuing house sells the share to the public and the price at which it buys from the company. So the price at which generally P1 would be slightly lesser, and depending on the risk that is present in this security, the difference between the P2 and P1 will exist. And generally, if I look at the timeline for this entire process, right, now that an issuing house is selected, generally 1 year before the actual launch, the issuing house, who has been already appointed by the company, it goes for, it looks at the pre-launch comments about the company. The pre-launch comments about the company in the press, they need to be more and more favorable. So it looks out for that kind of an opportunity. And if at all, I mean, whatever are the necessary changes, the memorandum of understanding, memorandum of association will get changed, wherein the company will get treated as a public limited company. These kind of changes they would make 1 year before. Then a few weeks before the issue, the actual advice on the price will come out. Once they have really viewed the comments from the press and comments from the outside world, there will be an advice on the price. The issuing house will do a kind of evaluation, and it comes out with an with some kind of a ballpark figure on the price. Many a time this ballpark figure is more and more conservative. Generally the price would be conservative, and what we see is this price is generally not set until the formal prospectus is published, right? I mean, all the other workaround will happen, but only at the time of final prospectus, which is typically called as the impact day. On that day, the prospectus is issued, the offer price is really set, and this prospectus is made available to the public. And this comes at least in one national newspaper and various other channels is very much other channels are available from the publishing perspective. And this prospectus contains lots and lots of information about the company, the various business activities of the company, the various lines of business in which the company is operating, the financial details including the financial statements, and what is the main purpose behind the issue, going for this, going for raising this new capital, and the list of various underwriters and various stakeholders who are a part of this issue. And the entire prospectus will also contain an application form seeking the application from the investors in terms of subscribing to the shares. And the application form wise, the applications are invited from the public to buy the securities. probably right from the day they have issued the prospectus, probably one week to 10 days, you can see that this subscription process or the application process typically goes. And there is a possibility that during this period, there could have been an oversubscription. Means the number of applications that the issuing house would have received could be much more than the number of shares that could be issued. And so from there, the issuing house has to really decide what is the basis of allocation. To whom should we allocate the shares? In what proportion should the allocation of the shares be accepted? Should it be acceptance in full? And what is the kind of, what is the rejection criteria? And what is the mechanism of scaling down? If someone has gone for 100 shares, probably should we give them only 50 shares? What is the kind of a mechanism that is built into this? All these things need to be discussed by the issuing house. And whosoever are the successful applicants finally, for them, the letter of acceptance would be sent. So their applications are accepted, and for them, their checks are realized, and typically the shares would be allotted to them. And for the remaining, either for whom the rejection has happened or for whom the scale down has happened, the refund checks are typically sent to all of them. And even this letter of acceptance, until the share certificate gets issued, the letter of acceptance is also a kind of a mechanism which can be used for trading purposes. So this is the typical process that goes around the offer for sale, especially associated with a fixed price mechanism, which is the most common form of raising capital, going for a full-fledged quotation from the exchange. But in some cases, with a slight difference, we see offer for sale by tender. Now, tender offer itself is, there will not be a fixed price, right? Rest all will be the same. The fixed price will not be there. Only a minimum price will be set. Now it is up to the buyers at what price they want to buy the shares and how many number of shares they want to buy. The buyers can very well bid for it, right? So there is no specific predetermined price, and it's purely a tender where the buyer has to really state how many shares he is going to buy and the price at which he can buy, right? So what generally happens is, probably after, again, the application close process, right? The application process and all remains the same. After the application close, the issuing house comes out with a single strike price. Generally, this single strike price is the highest price where all stock can be allocated. Now, what does it mean? Probably, let's say there are 100 people who agreed to buy at $100, 200 people who have agreed to buy at 120, 500 people who have agreed to buy it at 140. And 600 people have agreed to buy at 150. Now, let's say if for a company there are 1,000 shares to be allotted. So what it will typically see are, probably there are 1,000 more people who are willing to pay 2,000. Who are willing to pay 200. Now, it is the highest price which the company can typically set where all the issues can be sold. So probably if there are 2,000 shares to be allotted, all right, there are 1,000 people who are ready to buy it at 200, 600 people who are ready to buy it at 150, 500 people who are ready to buy it at 140. So all put together is 2100 shares. Only 2000 need to be allocated. So probably let me decide 500 or 140 to be the strike price, because at least there are 2000 people who can very well pay 140 bucks or above for purchasing the share. So for these people, it would be rejected. And for these people, the share allocation will happen. Of course, now there are only 2000 shares, but there are 2100 people who are willing to buy. Now there could be an algorithm or a mechanism in what way the allocation can happen. So in some cases, probably this could be the price, or in some cases, the company the issuing house doesn't mind even setting this as the price, especially if it is really looking out for a sufficient spread of the shareholders, rather than the shares being concentrated in the hands of quite a few of them. Probably if they want more and more spread in the shareholders, they don't mind even reducing it slightly below and trying to pull in more and more shareholders and try to allocate the shares in small proportions to more number of shareholders. And all the applicants who have really bid lesser than that strike price, their applications are rejected. And those who have bid more than that, their applications are accepted, and probably either full allocation or a proportionate allocation would be done for that. So this is what happens in a offer for sale by a tender process. There is no fixed price for buying and selling. Rather, it is decided by the buyers themselves. And the third mechanism, which is the offer for subscription. As I have already hinted earlier, it is not a fixed price. Or it could be at a fixed price also. Similarly, it could be by tender also. But whatever is the mechanism here, this is not underwritten. Means the issuing house does not come into picture here for buying, for making sure that the shares are sold to the public. Here, the company itself directly sells the shares to the public. So the company itself bears the risk of undersubscription. It's not the issuing house that is bearing the risk of undersubscription, but it is the originating company, the issuing company itself will bear this risk. Here, the issuing house is just being engaged as an advisor, probably in terms of the determination of the price, in terms of taking care of the initial activities, but there is no underwriting role in this mechanism offer for subscription. Then, we have a private placements are typically called as placings, right? It's also called as selective marketing, which is very clear. Here, no public is getting involved, right? No invitations are obtained, no applications are invited from the public. Only a select few institutional investors are chosen, and the shares of the company are typically being sold to a select few institutional investors only. Means the cost is much, much lesser. It's a cheaper kind of a mechanism. It's simpler, not too much of disclosure requirements are needed, because the shares are not shared with the general public. And generally a good mechanism if the issue size is small. So this is called as a private placement mechanism, wherein here also the issuing house comes into picture. The issuing house from the company, the issuing house buys the shares, and it will approach different institutional investors, where probably it could be life insurance companies, it could be pension funds. So different kinds of specific institutional houses are approached. And the typical issue is being sold to them. So no public is involved in this kind of a process. This is one more mechanism. And the final thing is an introduction kind of a mechanism. Here, a small difference is no new capital is raised. No new shares are issued. It's only that the existing shares will be available on the exchange. No new shares are issued in this process. Only the existing shares typically go and now are available on the exchange so that the buying and selling can happen on those existing shares. Right? Now, in the typical offer for sale via the fixed mechanism or via the tender mechanism or even in the private placements, what we have seen is the underwriting is a one major task, because that is what is taken care of by an issuing house, who is really assessing the risk that is associated with the shares and still taking the responsibility of getting the shares issued to the public. Right? So the underwriter who has taken this responsibility, that underwriting company has really purchased all the shares at an agreed price from the company, and it is responsible for selling the shares to the public. So there is a fee that is charged, and in general, as I have said, it is the difference between the two prices. The price at which the underwriter would be selling the shares to the public minus the price at which it would have bought the shares from the company. And here this underwriter or the issuing house, it is accepting the risk. It knows that all the shares may not be bought. So under subscription risk is generally accepted by the issuing house. So what it generally tries to do, instead of retaining all that risk, it will try to transfer this risk. What does it do? It comes in with a sub-underwriting process. Means the lead underwriting firm, which is the issuing house, it approaches various large financial institutions and banks to act as sub-underwriters in the process by paying a fee in the form of a commission to them. So again, these people are in turn responsible for taking some portion of the shares and getting them issued to the public or to the clients. But at the same time, even in case the issue does not get fully subscribed, to their portion, they are absorbing the risk. So overall, the entire risks are getting spread over, not just with the lead underwriter, but even with the hands of sub-underwriters as well. And to a large extent, as a part of this underwriting, to make sure that the underwriting process is successful, the issuing company will make sure that the overpricing of the shares does not exist. Very, very conservative in terms of pricing. Because major problem is, what if some kind of an unexpected event occurs? Right from the time they have agreed to go ahead with the issuing of the shares to the public to the time that they have really issued the shares. Within that meanwhile, if some unexpected, drastic, tremendous kind of negative event occurs, probably there is a possibility that the share gets undersubscribed. So the underwriting process really needs to take care of this particular unexpectedness that can come out. And regarding the profits, if the share is fully subscribed, yes, no issues. The underwriters, the sub-underwriters, everyone is making a profit, because P2 minus P1, the price at which they have sold the shares to the public minus the price at which they have got the shares from the company, this is always positive. So even after we remove some kind of expenses here, there is always a positive number. So there is a profit even after any kind of administrative expenses being removed out of it. But in case the issue is partially subscribed or undersubscribed, that is where the real problem comes for both the lead underwriter as well as the sub underwriter. Because on one side, for whatever they have underwritten, they are making a profit. But whatever did not get subscribed, they have to really purchase that. For all those shares which are not been purchased, they have to purchase and they have to take the risk of selling them to the public at a later date. So that is one major risk they are typically taking. And they have to be prepared for that. So just in a simple form, whenever I look at an underwriting, it looks like a kind of an insurance contract for me. That insurance, especially the company has taken to protect itself from an unsuccessful issue. So it is ready to pay a kind of a fee or a commission to the issuing house to make sure that all its shares are subscribed by the public. And even if they are not subscribed, probably the issuing house and the lead underwriter along with the sub underwriters will take the responsibility of the owning up all the shares. So from a company standpoint, they are able to issue all the shares to the they are able to issue the number of shares which they have really thought of. So that is the typical story behind the companies going for a full stock exchange quotation, getting the shares listed on the exchange, all these kind of things. All right.